praise. Psalms 148 says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. We exalt him today. He is the name above all names. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is Jesus Christ, our Savior, and we worship him and give him all the praise and all the honor. Would you give him all the honor and praise this morning? Amen. Well, before you're seated, would you greet one another and give somebody a high five? All right, if you guys want to make your way back to your seats. My name is Tracy Kimo, and I'm a volunteer here at CASE. And I just want to take the time this morning to welcome you. If this is your first time, we want to welcome you. And there is a Connect card in the seat pocket in front of you, or behind the chair, if you're sitting in the front. If you want to fill that out, put your name and information down. We'd love to get connected with you. And a special announcement I get to make this morning, if you want to put the picture up there, is our second grandson was born yesterday. He decided to come quite early. He's 34 weeks. They're all doing good. He is, his name is Kimo. James Kelly Ortiz. So for those of you who know Grandpa, his name is Kelly Kimo, so he's very, very blessed and touched by that. Just keep them in your prayers. Kayla hasn't been able to actually see Kimo yet. She's in a different area and has the sniffles, and so they're kind of working things out, and being a new mom and not being able to see and hold your baby is quite hard. And so just keep them in their prayers. We don't know how long he'll have to stay in, but he's here and he's healthy. And I was saying yesterday, it's funny because, you know, this is one way that we can get more members of our church is to just keep having the babies. So anyways, we're so blessed. We certainly have a lot of those babies in this church and we're so thankful. We love them all. Anyways, again, I want to welcome you here this morning. And we do want to get connected with you. One of the other things that we like to do here is to pray with you. If you have a need, find somebody today. Somebody would love to pray with you. If you want to send a prayer request to the church, there is a prayer at thechurchse.com, and somebody will definitely be praying for you. Another way that we love to give at this church is in our offerings. And if you're a regular with us in your tithe, you know how to do all of that. But if you're new this morning and you would like to give, there's a few ways that you can give. There is a booth at the back that has debit, credit. We take checks, cash, whatever method you have, then we'll certainly help you with that. You can also go to our website, or you can e-transfer at giveatthechurchse.com. Anyways, we want to just thank you for all that you give this morning, and bless the rest of the service. We want to pray for the offering right now. Father, we thank you for all that you've given us, Lord God. Father, we rejoice in who you are. And Father, we just thank you that we can give back to you, Lord, in every sense of our life, God. With whatever we do and whatever we give. And Lord, we just give you this offering today, Lord, and we pray that you just multiply it and use it for your kingdom, Lord God, and may it just give you glory and honor and praise. We love you so much, Jesus. We just are so grateful. You are the higher name above all the names. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the heart. Finished worshiping yet, there's still another song, but the whole way through that song, the Holy Spirit has been speaking to me and telling me that there's someone in this room that the Lord wants to heal today. You have some kind of arthritic type problem with your joints, but you also have something to do with your blood. It's to do with your immune system, and the two things are connected. And I don't understand how the two things are connected, but if this is you, this will sound familiar. So if there's someone here with you have an arthritic type condition, and there's also, there is someone here, right, who has an arthritic type condition in your joints, and also your immune system seems to be very low or something like that. Who is that person? Come out. We're going to pray for you. Come on out. Give her an encouragement as she comes out. Both of those things. Stretch out your hands to her. Do you know, the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. The presence of the Lord is here. Jesus said if we gather together in his name, he would be in our midst. If Jesus was here right now, do you think he would heal her? Is Jesus here right now? Okay, turn around and face me. Right. Just do that with your hands. Were you expecting this today? Father, we just pray for your daughter here, that you have called her out. You've identified her in the congregation. You've called her out. Your presence is going to come upon her. And we just pray for these two conditions, Lord. We ask, as I lay my hands upon her, as we all stretch our hands out to her, may you lay your divine healing hand upon her in the name of Jesus. May your power radiate the whole way through her body, all the way through her bones, all the way through her joints and sinews, all the way through her bloodstream, all the way through her white blood cells, Father God. I'm asking that this condition be nipped in the bud today in the name of Jesus. It will not progress any further. In fact, it shall go into retreat in Jesus' name, and the recovery shall begin right here, right now, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, come on, let's give God a praise in the house. Bless you. Let's continue to worship.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy. You are worthy. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you.
Come on, church, lift it up.
To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you.
I'll sing that again, come on.
To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. To worship you I live, to worship you I live to worship you. Oh, 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 oh.
Whatever you need to receive from the Lord right now, just in your heart, ask Him. We're in His presence. We've already prayed for healing for one person. Maybe there's other people who need to receive, right? There's a verse in Luke's Gospel. It says, "And Jesus was in the house, and the power of the Lord was present to heal the sick." This morning, Jesus is in the house. And the power of the Lord is present to meet every need and answer every prayer. Just ask Him, believe it, and receive it right now. In Jesus' name, we thank you. You're a good God. You give good gifts to your children. Every good and perfect gift comes down from above. And we receive it. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, let's give God a shout of praise in the house. Before you sit down, if we're going to send the kids out to Kids Church, if you have already signed your kids in at Kid Check before the service, send them down the front right now. If you haven't signed your kid in yet, hold on to them because you need to take them out and sign them in before you go. But the ones that are already signed in, come on, come on. Do you remember, come on down, the price is right? Does anybody remember that? The rest of you can take a seat. Go ahead and take a seat. stretch out your hands to the kids and their workers. Father, we pray for all of our children here, the ones that are going out to get checked in, and all of the kids' team. May your hand of blessing be upon them in a real way today, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Give them a big encouragement as they go out that side door there. On you go. Well, good morning, church. Last week, we started a new message series called Success Secrets from Scripture. Success Secrets from Scripture. If you've got a lisp, that's a hard title to say. Success Secrets from Scripture. And today, it's part two. We're going to be looking at the topic of responsibility. Responsibility. Taking personal responsibility for your life. But just in case you weren't here last week, or you were, but you weren't paying attention, we will just do a recap of two things. Number one, here is the basic premise. Let's put it up on the screen. The basic premise is the Bible contains, say it with me, let's read this together. The Bible contains practical advice for living a successful, fulfilling, and meaningful life. There's lots of stuff about that. Now, usually someone says, well, what about the apostles and the early Christians that were thrown to the lions? Or what about, you know, people in Christians in Pakistan that are being persecuted? Okay, the Bible also talks about persecution, right? The Bible talks about persecution. It talks about unstable times coming into countries and politics and all of that. But with the exception of that, the general rule and the general teaching of Scripture is not only does God want us to have life after death, but he wants us to have life before death, life and life more abundantly. Okay? So, with the exception of the fact that times of persecution might come and things like that, that aside, the general rule is that we should be using our faith in God and the promises he has given us to build a better life. So that's the basic premise. Last week, I gave you a definition of success. So could you put that up? Here's the definition of success that I'm talking about. I'm not talking about having lots of bling. I'm not talking about success in the way that the world might define it. But I'm talking about living a fulfilling, stable, and truly abundant life as you discover and progressively achieve your God-given unique purpose. Now, at the end of this message, I'm going to come back to this, that everyone has a different God-given unique purpose. And if your God-given unique purpose is to be an elementary school teacher, you will not get extra points with God if you become an international evangelist. But that's more spiritual. But you weren't called to do that. Do you know what's more spiritual? Do you want to know what the most spiritual thing is? Being the best you that you can possibly be, because God made you different than everybody else. Okay? And so this is a definition that we're looking at. And last week we talked a little bit, the topic last week was competence and how God will not give you something that you're not yet competent to handle. We looked at the parable of the talents. The master gives out talents according to people's ability. So you want to be the CEO of Amazon.com, but you can't even tidy your bedroom. You are not competent. You can pray all you want to be the CEO, but you're not competent. to do that. So God won't give you it. He will give out talents according to our abilities. Now, if you want God to give you more, you need to grow in competence. Okay? You need to develop yourself. It's like you don't go into the gym and say, what's the heaviest weight you've got? Lay it on me. You know? You go in there and you pick up those little lady weights first. You know the little pink ones? You do them first. And then eventually, as you become more competent, as you grow stronger, you are able to carry more weight. Isn't that true? And so if you want God to bless you more, to give you more, become more competent, grow more. That was competence. Now today is, we're talking about responsibility. And out of all of the messages we're going to do in this series, this is probably the most important one, because if you don't get this, none of the rest matter. And it's also the hardest pill to swallow. Because we love blaming everybody else for our problems, don't we? And not taking personal responsibility. So here's today's principle. Let's have a look at it. Next slide. There. Today's success principle, responsibility. Read it with me, will you? You need to take personal responsibility for your life. It is your responsibility to build your life, to take what God has given you and to multiply it and do something with it. We won't read it because we read it last week, but in the parable of the talents, it tells us, Jesus told us, that God gives us different things, and then the master, or Jesus, goes away, but one day he will return and ask us what we did with what he gave us, right? This is really important because a lot of people think that it's God's job to run their life. Have you ever heard this? Why did God do A, B, and C to me? Have you ever heard somebody saying something like that? So it's God's job to run your life. So when you die and get to heaven, God's going to give an account to you about what he did with your life? No, that's not going to happen. You're going to give an account to God about what you did with your life. I know this is a cliche, but it's true. Your life is God's gift to you. What you do with it is your gift back to him. Okay? So you are personally responsible for your life. And you're the one that's in charge of your life. Now, that doesn't mean that it's not possible that other people couldn't do something bad to you, right? It's possible. You know, you might have been the victim of something. Somebody might have done something bad to you. A business partner might have cheated you and your business went bankrupt and you lost everything you worked for years. Marriage partner might have betrayed you. The government might have seized your bank account because you donated to the wrong charity or something like that. You know, I mean, like, injustices happen in this world, don't they? But is it true that there's someone else in the world who experienced the same injustice as you and got over it? Well, doesn't that mean that you could get over it too? Now, I want to tell you something interesting. Last night, the topic today is taking personal responsibility for your life. Last night, before I went to bed, I checked Facebook and it said, you have memories. So I clicked on the memories. I want to read you this. I thought this was great. 8 years ago, yesterday, I posted this on Facebook. You, April 13th, 2016, right? You must take personal responsibility for your own life. You have been gifted by God and created as a unique individual with unique qualities and the ability to do something great with your life. Do not listen to the narrative that you are a helpless victim because of your color, your gender, your age, your nationality, your education, your financial status, or something that someone did to your ancestors hundreds of years ago. Right? If others have overcome those barriers, you can too. Get rid of all victimizing narratives and believe that you are created in the image of God and endowed with the ability to build a better life. Wasn't that fantastic? 8 years ago, and here we are today talking about... That's not a coincidence, is it? Look, here's what the Bible says. Let's look at the next slide. Here's what the Bible says. Deuteronomy 30, verse 18. Today I have given you the choice between life and death, between blessings and cursings. Now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you would choose life, that you and your descendants might live. God is telling us that we have the power of choice. And we can choose wisely or we can choose foolishly. But whatever we choose, we will face the consequences of it. How many of you have seen Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade? Remember the bit where the guy drinks out the Holy Grail and then turns to a corpse? Remember that bit? And the old knight says, he chose foolishly. And then Indiana takes the wooden cup, you chose wisely. One brought life and health, and one brought death. We are victims of our own decisions very often. Even if you're a victim of what someone else did to you, you now have the choice what you do. Are you going to want vengeance on them? Is that going to be your focus? Are you going to want sympathy on yourself? Is that going to be your focus? Or are you going to brush all of that off, become the person God created you to become, and your answer to that is going to be to become outrageously successful. And that person that tried to do you harm is going to have to stand and watch as the blessing of the Lord lands upon you. Like Joseph, they might throw you in prison. They might make you a slave. They might lie about you. They might do this. They might do that. But the cream always rises to the top. And I want to tell you something. God has made you something unique. And you can rise to the top of whatever situation you're in. And we are responsible to make a decision about the way our life is going to go. And we do that every day. We do that with it. What thoughts do you allow your mind to be filled with? Like, really, what thoughts do you fill your mind with? The thoughts that you fill your mind with, the thoughts that you think, the images that you visualize, the emotions that you generate, the words that you speak, the actions that you take, all of that charts the course of your life. But very often we allow life to dictate to us. And then when life doesn't go the way we want it to go, we blame God or we blame the devil. I mean, listening to some Christians, you would think the devil had a full-time job just following that person around. You know, oh, the devil's done this and the devil's done that, and oh, my car got repossessed, the devil repossessed my car. No, you never paid your freaking bill for 6 months. Nothing to do with the devil. Right? And so, well, it was God then. He never provided the money to pay. You signed paperwork that you couldn't afford. Do you remember Adam and Eve? Remember God came to Adam and said, what have you done? And he said, it was a woman. He blames the woman, and then he blames God. It was the woman that you gave me. And then God says to the woman, what have you done? It was the devil. The devil made me do it. We love to pass the buck. And even though it is true that tragedy and disappointment and discouragement and even devastation can come into our lives at the hands of other people, that does not mean you have to stay the victim of what happened. Because, you know, Jesus was killed at the hands of other people. But on the third day, he got up again. And I want to tell you something. The same power that raised Christ from the dead is in you. And whatever is burying you in life, God will cause you to rise up out of it again. Look at what it says in Corinthians. I can't remember. 2 Corinthians. It says, we must all stand before Christ to be judged. We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done while in this earthly body. Now, if you've put your faith in Jesus, you're saved, right? But we still have to give an account for our life. And it's what we have done, not what God has done with our life, but what we have done with our life. So think about life. Think about life. Are you a victim of life? Or are you more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ? Because listen to this statement. Does life happen to you? Or does life happen through you? Because your perspective on that will decide on whether you're happy or unhappy, fulfilled or unfulfilled. You see, some people see their life, see themselves as like a piece of cork on the sea. Or maybe a boat, a sailboat, but the sail's down on the sea. And wherever the wind and the waves take you, that's where you'll end up. Oh, you've been run aground on a sandbank. Oh, life's thrown me a curveball. Here I am. Because you just, wherever the current of life takes you. But other people put their sail up. And the wind is no longer happening to them, but they're catching the wind in the sail and they're directing the boat in a particular direction, and they will make it safe to harbor. The stuff that goes on in life happens to everybody. It happens to good people and bad people. It happens to Christians and non-Christians. The rain falls on the righteous and the unrighteous. The sun shines on the good and the bad. The question is, will you unfurl the sail of faith and get your direction from God? And will you have a goal in mind, a harbor that you're going to, and will you guide your life in the direction that you know it's meant to go, or will you just bob around all over the place? You see, at the end of the day, I can't change other people, even if they're bad to me. I can't change them. Can't change them. The only person I can change is me. And I can come to God with me, and I can say, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Renew my mind. When you get up in the morning and you look in the mirror, that is the person that you need to change. I think I've got a little title for that. It says, it's time, take radical, personal responsibility for the man in the mirror. I saw a video just recently, and it was a preacher preaching at a big conference, and he was going on about how preachers are always blaming the devil for this and the devil for that, and the devil's coming against me and the devil's doing this. And then it was one of these conferences for all the elders set up in the platform, you know, and they all wear nice suits with ties and all of that, and they're all sitting up there, and he's going on about the devil attacking us, and he calls his pastor over and he says, "Do you want to know who's responsible for all your problems?" And he put his phone onto camera and he said, "Him. Him. You, the person in the mirror, the man in the camera. Take radical personal responsibility for the man in the mirror. And if you can do that, you can make your life become what it's supposed to do. And then all the people around you, it's like a domino effect. Their lives become what they're meant to be." I want to close by telling you a story. How many of you have heard of David Wilkerson or Nikki Cruz or read a book or seen a movie called The Cross and the Switchblade? Anybody ever seen that? Seen that movie or read the book? So David Wilkerson was a pastor. He was a pastor in a rural area, and he felt that God was calling him to go to New York, to go to the inner city, and to reach the gangs. So he goes there, and he begins to reach the gangs, and they begin to be saved. And he wants everyone to know about this because a whole new ministry is starting. So he writes a book about it. But David Wilkerson's a pastor. And most pastors are not renowned for their ability to handle large sums of money well. Some are, but a lot aren't, right? And so he wants to publish this and to get the message out. Have any of you ever read a book called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill? Anybody ever read that? Okay. So you will know that Napoleon Hill had a mentee, a guy that he was mentoring called Clement Stone, and they wrote a book together. Let's put that one up. It's called Success Through a Positive Mental Attitude. Has anybody ever read this book? Success Through, it's a good book, by Napoleon Hill and Clement Stone. Clement Stone was a very, very successful, wealthy businessman. And he learned everything from Napoleon Hill. So I want to go back a few steps. Napoleon Hill, he felt that his mission in life was, and he was given this mission kind of by Andrew Carnegie, but he felt his mission in life was to research what made people successful and then teach it. And that's what he did. And his most famous book was Think and Grow Rich. So I'm going to do the research and I'm going to teach this. Then this guy comes along, Clement Stone. And Napoleon Hill teaches all this to Clement Stone. Clement Stone does it and becomes a multimillionaire businessman who sets up a foundation and puts millions into this foundation. And in this foundation, he finances lots of charities, especially Christian charities. And one of the things he finances is the Cross and the Switchblade. David Wilkerson is called by God to preach the gospel, but he needs a wealthy financial backer who needed to be taught those principles by a teacher. Do you see that if every person does their job, all the jobs get done? We don't all need to be preachers. We all need to be the person that God has made us to be and become successful at that. And not only does that fulfill our life, but it then begins to affect the lives of other people. Now, Clement Stone also published a magazine called Success Magazine. And he wrote an article in it once about Napoleon Hill. You know the people, the three people we're talking about? So he wrote an article about Napoleon Hill. And here's the story. One day Napoleon Hill's sitting in his office and his secretary comes in and says, there's a homeless man here to see you. And he said the police sent him. And he says, well, I haven't started my day yet. I've got no meeting. Send him in. So this homeless man comes in and sits in front of Napoleon Hill. And he says, what can I do for you? And he said, well, I was standing on a bridge about to jump and commit suicide. And this police officer stopped me. And he said, look, I can either take you to a cell for the night, or I can take you to see this man down the road, Napoleon Hill. Maybe he could talk you into changing your life. He said, let's do that. So that's what they did. So he goes, and Napoleon Hill says to the man, well, why were you going to commit suicide? Well, comes, I'm homeless and I'm broke. How did you end up homeless and broke? And the man tells him his story. And Napoleon Hill remembers reading the story in the newspaper. This man had been a successful restaurant owner, had a fantastic restaurant that was very popular, that everyone came to. He was very successful. And then something happened, a bad business deal, someone let him down, and this man became bankrupt. He lost his business, he lost his wife, he lost his kids, he lost his house, and he ended up going from this successful restaurant owner to being homeless under the bridge. And he was so discouraged and so defeated that he was ready to commit suicide. And Napoleon Hill said to him, I can't do anything to help you, but I know a man who can. This is not going where you think it's going. I know a man who can, and he's in the building right now. Would you like me to introduce you to him? And the guy said, yes. He said, come on over here. And they walked over to this wall. There was a curtain. And Napoleon Hill pulled the curtain back, and there was a full-length mirror with the man standing in front. And Napoleon Hill said, see that man in the mirror? That's the only man that can help you. When that man makes a decision to turn his life around, that's when your life will get turned around. And the man turned to Napoleon Hill and said, thank you for not babying me. I know what I have to do. And the man left that office and walked down the road to the Salvation Army, went in and saw them. They gave him a shower, shaved, cut his hair, gave him clothes, gave him a place to spend the night and a meal. He gave his life to Jesus. He went for an interview the next day. He got a job. He became a dishwasher in a restaurant. Then he became a cook in the restaurant. Then he bought the blooming restaurant. And then he came back to see Napoleon Hill and said, if you had not challenged me to take personal responsibility of my life, I would not be where I am. But once I took personal responsibility, I found out that God had all these other people in the Salvation Army and everywhere else to help me achieve the goal that I was looking for. And so when you make a decision, God will come on the scene and will help you out. Here's what it says in closing in the book of James. It says this, put it up please. It says, don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourself. For if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it's like glancing at yourself in a mirror. It's like glancing at yourself. The Bible's like a mirror. When you look in the Bible, it's like looking in a mirror and seeing all your flaws. Where did that wrinkle come from? Oh my goodness, there's another gray hair. You see all your flaws. You're a sinner. You're lost. You've turned away from God. You see all your flaws. But you also see your new identity. You're a new creation in Christ. You can do all things through Christ. If God is for you, who can be against you? You begin to see that all things are possible to those who believe. He says, you see yourself and you walk away and you forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the scriptures and you see what God says about you, if you look perfectly into the law the law doesn't bind you, it sets you free. And if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, God will bless you for doing it. How many of you want God to bless you? Give me a little wave. Give me jazz hands. Right, come on, let's stand up then. We're going to pray. We're going to pray for God to bless us. And the reason God's going to bless us is because we're going to leave here and we're going to do what the Bible says. We're going to take personal responsibility for our life. We're going to make wise choices that lead to life. And we're going to glorify God in all that we do. Can you say amen? Hands up in the air. Let's say this together, right here and right now. Say it with me, right here and right now. I declare in the name of Jesus, my life belongs to God. Devil, get your hands off. I am blessed. I am forgiven. I am healed. I am prosperous. I am anointed. I am a child of God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I believe it. I receive it. And in Jesus' name, I will achieve it. Amen. Amen.
One name is higher. One name is stronger than any grave, than any throne. Christ exalted. To you alone, our praise belongs. Christ exalted over all. To you alone, our praise belongs. Christ exalted over all. To you alone, our praise belongs. Christ exalted over all.
Amen. What an awesome message. Let us take authority over our life. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I want to wish you all the best this week. We're going to just lift our hands and we're going to say this together, our closing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Have a good week, you guys. We'll see you next week.